Tonight, on behalf of Harvard Bookstore, I'm very pleased to introduce James K. Galbraith, discussing Inequality and Instability, a study of the world economy just before the Great Crisis. Professor Galbraith is Chair of Government and Business Relations at the Lyndon B. Johnson School of Public Affairs at UT Austin, where he holds a professorship in government. A graduate of Harvard and Yale, he has since served in countless distinguished positions and is currently senior scholar with the Levy Economic Institute and chair of the Board of Economists for Peace and Security. He is a frequent speaker on matters related to the current economic crisis and was called to advise Congress on the TARP legislation and recovery strategy in late 2008. Professor Galbraith is the author of many previous books, including 2008's The Predator State, How Conservatives Abandoned the Free Market and Why Liberals Should Too. His recent scholarly research has focused on the measurement and understanding of inequality in the world economy under the rubric of the University of Texas Inequality Project. In his new book, Inequality and Instability, Galbraith introduces the product of 15 years of data collection from public archives, data that provides the foundation for a new generation of inequality studies. We're very pleased to bring him to Harvard Bookstore this evening. Join me in welcoming James Kenneth Galbraith.
Thanks very much indeed, and I'm very happy to be here, so close to where I grew up and in the presence of some dear friends. While I have a well-known tendency to avoid exaggeration and hyperbole of all kinds, I also have to say that it's truly an honor to be here at what is beyond question the best bookstore in the world. This is a day when the results of the elections a couple of days ago in France and Greece, I think, call attention to some of the issues that I raise and discuss in this book, Inequality and Instability, to the implications of growing inequality in at least one part of the world for political stability and indeed for the endurance of a set of economic arrangements that were introduced with great hopes just a little more than a decade ago. My work in this area has an ethical element, or certainly an ethical perspective associated with the study of inequality, but I should be clear from the outset that the primary purpose of doing the book and bringing together the materials that that underpinned this volume is to present and evaluate evidence, to try and understand a little bit better what the facts of the matter are. That's the first task, it seemed to me to be an important one to undertake. And secondly, to make an assessment about the relationship between economic inequality and economic performance. Are these things associated? And if so, in what way? Can we say anything that's plausible and general about that? Is inequality something which we must tolerate in order to have acceptable economic performance? Or is it, on the other hand, perhaps something which acts as a drag or barrier to acceptable economic performance? Does it make things better or does it make things worse? This is, by the standards of the study of economics, a relatively recent line of work. For at least the first half of the post-war period, and through the time when I was growing up and getting my training as an economist, this area was substantially a backwater for a couple of reasons. One was that nothing much seemed to be happening. So when I was coming through graduate school, the study of inequality was described to me as watching the grass grow. And to the extent that things were happening, it appeared that inequality was gradually being reduced. And secondly, economists were preoccupied with what were called equilibrium states, steady state models, in which, in any event, the distribution of income was unlikely to change except as a matter of short-term fluctuations or perhaps long-term structural phenomena. And in either event, these were not the principal interests of economists. So this issue was a backwater until it began to emerge as a significant social and political issue, and that was in the 1980s. And in the course of the development of that discussion, it's fair to say that the economics profession, as a first step, developed a narrative, a discourse about this issue, which was in line with their preferred way of organizing thinking and developing explanations. It was a narrative of supply and demand, largely related to the functioning of what economists call labor markets, in which forces impinging on those markets were given substantial responsibility for what was being observed. In particular, suggested, and it is still being argued by prominent economists, that the principal source of rising inequality was technological change, and a differential between the rate of technological change and the rate with which the preparation of workers to deal with the skill demands of the new economy was proceeding. And there was a contrary argument to the effect that no, the really important matter was increasing international trade, that is to say, the supply of unskilled labor, migration, and of goods produced by less skilled or less well-paid workers, and the effect of that on the labor markets in the advanced countries. These were microeconomic forces, organized, as I say, in the way that economists are most comfortable with thinking and analyzing. A serious problem with this emerging work over quite a number of years was that the data that underlay it were very unpersuasive. Unpersuasive, really quite poor, often collected with enormous gaps in time and with lines of argument that did not withstand, I think, very close examination. Just for example, the idea that computers were driving the rise of inequality was something that I took up in an earlier book on this subject, and it became clear that the spread of the personal computers that were at issue here would actually came after the rise of inequality. It was very hard to attribute the thing that came earlier to the cause that came later, but that had nevertheless become a very substantial argument at that time. This was also true in analysis of the larger world economy, that is to say, of discussion of what was going on in the development economics literature, in the literature on economic growth more generally. There were extended discussions of whether equality supported more rapid economic growth, or whether, on the other hand, if you tolerated rising inequality, you get more savings and investment. According to one line of argument, you might get more rapid growth on that channel. And again, extremely hard to evaluate these arguments because once you began to examine the data on inequality at the world level, you found that it was full of gaps, consisted of measures which, while individually perhaps very well done and highly defensible, were measures of different concepts, sometimes income, sometimes expenditure, various different ways in which researchers approach this issue, and therefore very difficult to compare one for another. And therefore, the comparisons were extremely noisy and the results extremely tentative and unstable. That suggested to me, and I was able to attract an exceptionally talented group of graduate students, PhD students at the University of Texas at Austin over the years, to the project of improving and enhancing the underlying data sets to see if it was possible to put together a body of information at the national level, at the continental level in some cases, at the world level, that would provide us with consistent measurement so that one could track changes over time and compare the conditions across countries. I have to read just a short quotation with which I begin the book, since the author of it is a Cambridge philosopher, Charles Saunders Peirce, who wrote that Kepler undertook to draw a curve through the places of Mars, and his greatest service to science was in impressing on men's minds that this was the thing to be done if they wished to improve astronomy, that they were not to content themselves with inquiring whether one system of epicycles was better than another, but that they were to sit down to the figures and find out, in truth, what the curve was. That may be a bit grand for a project undertaken by mere economists, but nevertheless captures the spirit of what we are trying to do. And the question was it possible to do it? And the answer to that question turned out not only was it possible, it was really quite easy. Once we had gotten to the realization that it's possible to, let's say, approximate the movement of inequality from data sources that are quite routinely gathered by administrative agencies and by sometimes by international agencies, and using a mathematical measure which is akin to something developed originally by another Cambridge figure, Claude Shannon, down the road at MIT in information theory. It's very measures of inequality very closely associated with measures of information, which have the two nice properties. One is that they can be calculated from data that are collected on a grouped basis. You don't need to have individual level data in order to get quite good measures. And secondly, when you have group structures which are hierarchical, can be divided and subdivided ever more finely, say geographical data might be states, counties, down to precincts, you can essentially embed one set of measures in the next set of measures taken at one level and measures taken at the higher level. And this becomes something which gives you a very flexible set of techniques to do things that had not, in fact, been done before, such as adding up the inequalities within European countries and the inequality between them to ask what would be the measure of inequality for Europe taken as a continent, for example. And so there are a great many things that one can do with these measures that were available to anybody who happened to take this particular approach. And the simple fact was that nobody had. Okay, the book begins by approaching the problem at the world level. And here we encounter yet another Cambridge figure. It was, let's see, what was it? Who said that time, John Robinson said, time is a device to make sure that not everything happens at once. And space is a device to make sure that it doesn't all happen in Cambridge. She was referring to the other Cambridge, but never mind. From our point of view, it's still pretty good. The other figure, of course, is Simon Kuznets. Kuznets, in 1955, after a luminous run developing the national income accounts and helping the United States win the Second World War, turned his attention to worldwide development issues, and offered the hypothesis that as income improved in an initial stage of development, inequality would increase because what would be happening in that stage would be a transition from agriculture to industry, from rural to urban, and the differentials between the country and the countryside and the city would drive up inequality until such time as the cities came to predominate, in which case you would get a peak and then a tendency for things to decline again, for inequality to decline, as the processes of urban industrialization, social democracy, unionization, the rise of the welfare state, all of these things that people did believe in the 1950s, continue. That observation or argument, which seemed to be have a lot of power in the original approach to this literature, had gotten lost by the late 1990s because the data no longer appeared to support it clearly. And the question we faced was that a problem of the facts or a problem of the data? And I have actually a little correspondence with Paul Samuelson on this, in which he stated his view that Kuznets was right until he wasn't, right? Which I think was very much the accepted position on this issue. What we were able to show, I think, reasonably persuasively, and I'm here presenting this case for the first time without the benefit of a PowerPoint, so I'll just have to draw pictures in the air, is that it's really very hard. One should not have underestimated Simon Kuznets. It's really very hard to do better than that core insight that intersectoral transitions make a lot of difference to the movement of inequality. And if you look at a country like China, well, as it grows, inequality was increasing very rapidly. But if you look at many of the countries in the more industrialized developing world, whether you're looking at Brazil, Korea, Mexico, you have a tendency for strong growth to actually be reducing inequality because it tends to improve wages at the bottom. But we also found that if you look at the very wealthiest countries in the world structure, of which the United States is certainly a leading example, the curve tends to go up again. That is to say, and because the United States is a supplier to the world of advanced industrial products, capital goods, and financial services, when the U.S. is growing rapidly, it's the sectors at the very high end of the income distribution that are having the greatest gains, and so inequality in the U.S. tends to rise. So you get a kind of sideways S pattern. One of the things that appears to have happened, particularly in the 80s and 90s, if this is a roughly right stylized representation of the basic realities, is that you had relatively rapid growth in China, rising inequality there. At various times, particularly the late 1990s, relatively rapid growth in the US, rising inequality here. But because of the debt crisis and the crushing set of developments that started, that affected Latin America, Central Europe, and Asia, in the countries that are on the downward sloping surface, you had decline, you had problems. And so you had rising inequality there too. And so the theory predicts what appears to be in the evidence that you had rising inequality just about everywhere. Another way of looking at this, and it's these two are not straightforward to separate out, is to say that there was a common global pattern, and maybe the sideways S was not a stable phenomenon, but that one can observe in the data a worldwide trend, a worldwide set of movements of inequality. And we do this with a statistical technique. I won't need to trouble you with that here. But the one of the most, I think, strongest findings in the book is the fact that when you get a rich enough data set with enough consistency of measures, and this is measuring pay inequality, so it's not capturing everything in the distribution, but it is measuring some things which are readily measurable across countries, you find the following. You find that for the first years that for which we have consistent observations, which are the 1960s, there's no worldwide trend. Some increases, some decreases. Beginning in 1971, you begin to see a trend, and it's a trend of declining inequality for a while. And then in 1980, there's a turnaround and 20 years of dramatic increases, peaking in 2000. And just looking at that pattern without attempting to do statistical and causal analysis on it suggests to me very strongly that what we're looking here at here is something that is common to a global economy, say forces affecting the global economy emanating from a single source. Well, what could that source be? Well, the turning points and the direction of movement give you very powerful clues. The first turning point is 1971. What happened then was the breakdown of the Bretton Woods global financial system, which was a stabilizing system. What followed was a period through the end of the decade of credit boom and commodity boom in many parts of the developing world. And commodity booms and credit booms are quite good for promoting the growth of incomes amongst the poorer populations in the poorer countries. 1980-81, you get the debt crisis. And the debt crisis sweeps around the world, and you actually can see this if you map out the movements in our data. First big effect, the biggest effects are in Latin America and the parts of Africa for which we have observations. Then Central Europe, the Soviet Union, soon to be the former Soviet Union, in the late 1980s, and finally Asia and China in the 1990s. So one is looking at a pattern of in the inequality data, which is very closely associated with what one knows to be the pattern of global of succumbing, if you like, to global financial crisis. And then, as I say, there is a peak in 2000, and so far as we know so far, there is a tendency for things to stabilize and in some areas to get better, at least for inequality, to fall after that. And we are able, there's a chapter in the book that deals with Brazil and Argentina, for which we have very good data up to quite recently, and you can see declining inequality following the financial crises, following repudiation of neoliberal doctrine in those countries. So we're able, in some sense, to track out things both at the global level and at the national level. In the U.S. case, if one shifts the frame of observation a little bit from pay inequalities to inequalities of income, which is something that we measure very well in this country because we have tax data, which by international standards is very good, and one can measure it in all kinds of ways. A way that I happen to like because it I think is illuminating and gives you also something which you can represent visually very effectively, is to measure inequality between counties in the United States, which there are 3,150. And you can, if you do that and plot that out, and there is another graph, which I'll just have to represent with hand movements, but it rises to a very sharp peak in, guess what, 2000, and then comes down again, and then goes up again. And actually, I have more recent data than able to include in the book that shows a kind of sawtooth pattern up to within a year or so ago. What's going on in that data? Well, it is not only the same pattern of movement, it's the same proportional change as the stock market. Right? It is the NASDAQ represented in income tax data. Right? Just to say that measures of inequality of incomes in our country are very strongly influenced by what is going on in the income reports of very small numbers of people whose incomes are dominated by stock options realizations, capital gains, the incomes paid from initial public offerings, and leveraged variance on capital asset market valuations. That's what's going on in that data, overwhelmingly. Well, can we double check whether that intuition is correct? Well, yes, we can, because as I said, we have county data. And if you look at where the incomes are being booked, in this period, you can isolate the effects of individual counties on the overall measure of inequality. And you find that you can take out one county, and the peak in 2000 will be about 30% less than it was. What county is that? That's New York, New York. State of New York, County of New York, Manhattan. no great surprise in that, but a lot of very high incomes get booked there. Take out four more counties, and they are Santa Clara, San Mateo, and San Francisco counties in California, and King County, Washington, Seattle, and half of the rise of the inequality between counties goes away. Take out the top 15, including one around here, and it all goes away. Just to say, this is not the whole rise of inequality in the United States, it's just the rise measured between these geographic units, but it's a very significant piece of it by any standard. And what you're seeing is, I think, clearly shows that the concentration of income that we observed or economists picked up as rising inequality was a sectorally and geographically very specific phenomenon. It wasn't something that was spread all the way through the society where some fast food restaurateurs got rich relative to other fast food restaurateurs. This year, it'd be in information technology or the financing of it to get the full benefit of this. This is not something which is necessarily the same through time. It's always the case that the financiers do well with whatever they're financing. But if you then move the clock forward to the period 2003-2004, you find that the geographic beneficiaries of rising incomes, the most prominent case is, anybody want to guess? The counties immediately surrounding Washington, D.C. Right? For obvious reasons relating to the tremendous rise in the Pentagon budget at that time. Right? So this is government spending, military spending. And as I said at the time to an audience there, probably the best thing a Republican administration ever did for the real estate values of a nest of Democrats. But, there are ironies in this business. Then you can move the clock forward again to 2006, 2007, and look where the hot spots are, and what do you find? South Florida, Southern California, and other places where you're looking at the sort of the hot sites of real estate speculation leading up to the enormous debacle of housing finance that gave us the great crisis. And for this reason, I argue that what we're seeing when we measure inequality is substantial evidence of the instability of our economic situation, of our reliance on credit and equity booms, bubbles, to promote income growth, to promote employment. And this is something which is not necessarily a bad thing while you're experiencing it, but is almost certain to end badly, and has, in fact, ended badly. The NASDAQ boom ended, maybe not as badly as it might have been, might have done. But then a decade later, we really suffered a colossal collapse as a result of our reliance on this particular model of economic growth. And that's, I think, the essential method and message of the book. I want to say just a word, since I began with Europe, about some work that we do on the European scene. There is been a line of argument which has dominated European policy discussions up until the Great Crisis, which held that clearly the case that Europe was suffering from chronically higher unemployment than in the United States, and which laid the blame for that on rigidity in European labor markets. And so the line was that Europe was suffering from an excessive commitment to social democracy and the welfare state, from the dominance of strong trade unions, et cetera, et cetera. And the contrast was held to be with the United States, with our free market libertarianism, et cetera, et cetera, our greatly unequal and brutally unfair society. Well, one way to look at this problem, this question, or this hypothesis, argument, systematically, is to treat inequality in the structure of pay as a measure of rigidity or flexibility. since clearly the argument was that if you had unemployment, it's because you were not unequal enough. You were not allowing wages to rise for the skilled and to fall for the unskilled. And that was the problem the Europeans faced. Well, it turns out there's a lot of variation in inequality inside Europe, a gradient from north to south, nothing that would surprise you. And then Scandinavian countries, highly egalitarian, the Mediterranean countries, much less so. And you can ask whether there's any systematic relationship between that and unemployment. And the answer is there is, very strong relationship, but it doesn't go the way the model says. The hypothesis says quite the reverse. The countries which had stable, equalizing institutions have systematically less unemployment than the ones that didn't. When you think about that, you say, okay, is there economic theory consistent with that observation? The answer is, yeah, sure, there's lots of it. There are all kinds of plausible narrative accounts about job search and migration. Says that if you have a highly unequal society, people leave the bad jobs looking for the better ones, which are not numerous, and they're going to spend a lot of time. A lot of people are not going to get them. They're going to end up unemployed. You can apply that same model to modern China. What China has done is integrated a national market that was previously highly segmented, partly for military reasons. And as a result, with rising inequality, have massive migration from the countryside to the cities, and a lot of people, would-be construction workers, spend a lot of time unemployed in China. Many Chinese economists think this is the biggest problem they have. So that is the case inside Europe. What about the relationship between Europe and the United States? The core argument. Well, thinking about this for a second, I think you realize that everything depends upon what your frame of reference is, what you're looking at. If you measure the United States against any single European country, particularly the northern ones, of course, we're much more unequal. Right? But a comparison of the United States to Denmark is a profoundly unfair comparison. You know, we have, what, 340 million people? Denmark, last I looked, had 5.9 million cheese-eating social democrats in a cold northern climate surrounded by water. Now, if you want 5.9 million cheese-eating social democrats in a cold northern climate surrounded by water, in North America, we got one of those. It's called Wisconsin. I checked, 5.9 million. Right? And if you want, you know, Sweden, we've got Minnesota, you can make those comparisons. Right? Wisconsin is much more egalitarian than the United States is. Right? On the other hand, if you treat Europe as a single continental entity, then you have to take account of the fact that there are vast differences between European countries. Germany is much richer than Poland, let alone Portugal or Greece. Right? And across these long distances, these inequalities matter, among other things, because they would presumably induce multinational investors to go where labor is cheap, and also because they may induce migration as integration becomes more significant. In fact, what seems to be observed in Europe is concentration of activity in the richer countries and unemployment in the poorer ones. Right? And that is a phenomenon that's clearly evident as a source of the massive stress on the European Union. It was predicted. The European Union knew when it was being formed that it was going to have to support the economies of the peripheral regions, who are going to lose manufacturing to Germany and agriculture to Belgium, right? Which is very strange when you think about it, but it has happened. Right? But they did not take the steps that were necessary to prevent that from happening or to fully compensate for it. And the argument I would make, and I'll wrap up on this point, is that neither did we for a long time. And the relevant moment to date our failure, I think, is the end of the last effort in the North America to have a confederation. The Confederacy ended in 1865. And for 70 years after that, we had a radically unequal country with strong migration incentives, which ultimately led a large part of the population of the South to move to the North. Right? But beginning in the 1930s, we began to pursue policies which compensated and offset that, which developed the South so that it came up over 50 years to be about average for the U.S. and not to be the region of deep poverty that it was. Convergence, which has made possible the migration of itinerant professors from Cambridge to Austin, and so I'm quite happy with it. But which is something which tells you why a federation with stabilizing institutions is a stronger basis for a large economy to operate on than a confederation operating on neoclassical rules and principles. So that's, I think, one way in which the study of inequality can be integrated into a discussion of the current economic problems. And since I mentioned Texas, too, and I have to tell you that about 10 years ago, Senator Kennedy, still very healthy at that time, came to Austin for a political event. And I went to see him, needless to say, at one of the big hotels in downtown Austin. So I made my way to the front of the crowd, and he looked at me and said, "What are you doing here?" And I said, "Senator, we just have to recognize that this is just a warm suburb of Cambridge." He knew exactly what I meant. Thank you very much. Oh, I would say that I was attempting to suppress all thoughts of the Federal Reserve. And the reason is that I had to get up at 4 o'clock this morning, catch the 6 o'clock shuttle, and appear before the Committee on Financial Services in front of Congressman Ron Paul today. And I only just came back. The last stage of the financial debacle was the stage for that was set by a massive abandonment of public responsibility in the financial sector. I think that is clear. The Federal Reserve, as the lead regulator of the major banks, bears a heavy responsibility, but then also so do some of the players who were more directly involved with mortgage originators, the Office of Thrift Supervision, the Office of the Comptroller of the Currency. The Department of Justice, which removed 500 FBI agents from financial fraud in 2001, put them on counterterrorism, which was understandable, but never replaced them. Mr. James T. Gilleran, the first director of the OTS in the Bush administration, who famously came to a press conference with a stack of underwriting regulations and a chainsaw. This was not a subtle gesture. It was an attempt to convey to even the thickest member of the business press what the attitude of that agency was going to be. The more moderate colleagues from the OCC came with pruning shears. They were also, trying to get a point across. And the result can be read. I mean, there's some marvelous books that I'm sure are here, like Bethany McLean and Joe Nocera's All the Devils Are Here, Kathleen Engel and Patricia McCoy's book, The Subprime Virus. This is something that we all have experienced. There's vast evidence of the consequences of allowing, basically taking the coolant out of that reactor. You're going to get a meltdown and an explosion and a complete disaster from which you are not going to recover anytime soon. And I think one of the great failings of the Obama administration coming in was a denial about how much damage had been done, how big the cleanup would have to be, and a much too optimistic expectation of the path of return to normal. We have not returned to normal, not going to return to normal. It's just the reality. A federation is a more stable and effective system because it compensates for the tendency of a unregulated system to implode on itself, to concentrate for income basically to concentrate. And we've been doing that now for 70 years, not necessarily effectively in every dimension, in fact not, but on one dimension, interregional transfers, in fact, things have changed dramatically in this country from what was the case in the 1930s. Yeah? And I like the Confederation and the Confederacy example, because it does alert our European friends that they have the wrong idea.
Yep.
It's a graphic term, which I find useful. Sir?
Question.
The question is, what was the real truth?
Yeah.
And I shall fill in the details as I go along. And, I have considerable difficulty with the with framing policy, desirable policy, simply in terms of stimulus. I'm sensitive to medical metaphor. This one is a jab with a syringe full of amphetamines, right? Okay, it's something you might do to wake up an otherwise healthy individual who's lethargic, right? Sleeping in. It's not an effective approach to organ failure, okay? So just thinking through what the metaphor implied. The metaphor implies that if you just spend, cut taxes, whatever it is, cut interest rates, build up the money supply, whatever your favorite stimulant of choice is, and do this for a short period of time, then the system will kick back into motion and we will have a sustained and substantial recovery. I don't think this is true. I don't think it was true from the beginning of this meltdown. We suffered something we had not experienced since the 30s, which was the collapse of the stability of the financial sector, the viability of the financial sector, its trustworthiness, and of the solvency of the American middle class, because their housing values fell below their mortgages. Right? They're not in the market to borrow. So there isn't a foundation for the private sector to take over when the public sector is done. What do you need instead? You need something which is a strategic approach, something which is a long-term approach that builds new institutions, and we're going to have to dismantle some banks to make way for them. This is not something that gives me a great deal of heartburn, but we should have done it when the political opportunity was there, not waiting 5 years until they are entrenched once again with all their bonuses and lobbies. We missed that opportunity. Roosevelt did not miss it in March of 1933. We are going to have to build up, as I say, institutions that will permit us to do things that need to be done. Jobs, the foreclosure crisis, energy, the environment and climate change, the challenges that we all know we face, infrastructure. We are going to then have to set a direction which gives private players, private sector actors, entrepreneurs, a good sense that if they follow down that line, if they commit themselves, that they'll make a profit. That's what you want to do. That's how you get the private sector involved in something. But if you do take the stimulus approach, you've got to ask yourself, what does a sensible business person think? A sensible business person thinks, well, gee, it's okay, I'll stay in business for the next couple of years because the government is paying the incomes of my customers, right? The school teachers and the police and the fire and the beneficiaries of tax reduction, anything that happens to be getting income out of this. But 2 years from now, the government's going to be withdrawing this stimulus and these people are going to be on the street. So am I going to commit to an investment which will come online in 18 months? I don't think so under those conditions. I wouldn't do it. I'm not a very cautious person, but it seems to me that's the message you send when you assume things are going to be okay. And there are models, multiplier accelerator models and things that economists use to say, oh, that's all going to be fine. But those models were built up in the 50s and 60s when we weren't facing anything like the conditions we're facing now. So that's the real truth, the whole truth. First of all, going back to the 30s, I would not describe Roosevelt's 30s as Keynesian stimulus. Keynes's influence on Roosevelt was really very minor until 38. What you got with the alphabet soup was, these were Reconstruction agencies, Reconstruction Finance Corporation, the Tennessee Valley Authority, Agricultural Adjustment Administration. They were looking at sector by sector, the National Industrial Recovery Administration. This was not Keynes. This was really the Brains Trust and a try-anything approach to what were considered was considered to be an unlimited meltdown of the previous system, an unlimited implosion of the previous system. Okay, what's the difference that we face now as compared to then? I think it's reasonably straightforward. In the 30s, 40s, and 50s, we were riding on the cusp of enormous energy discoveries that enabled us to transform our economy technologically. We moved from coal to oil, and that meant cars and roads and trucks and aircraft. It also meant a military apparatus that gave us world dominance. And that, you know, the difference between the U.S. on the one side, Germany and Japan on the other, was had a lot to do with what was in Texas at that time. So where are we now, and where have we have been moving since 1970 away from that position of advantage. And since 1980, in the 1970s, we actually paid some attention. We had some serious reasons to understand that our position was changing, not because of ecological concerns, but simply because we were importing more and more. And that has an effect on
importing,
yes, yeah. But since 1980, we've been denying it. And we've been assuming that there were other ways to get around this problem. I don't think there are anymore. And there are two issues. One is the direct cost of the resources, right? what it costs actually to control and obtain them, irrespective of the environmental consideration. So there's a direct cost issue. And then there is the cost of using them, which we now recognize to be very, very large. That is, again, part of dealing with that is part of the strategic problem. It is, I think, in many ways, the key part of the strategic problem. Facing the world, but facing the U.S. To the extent that we think of this in national terms, certainly facing the U.S. This is not something I deal with in this book. Go wait for the next one. It is the issue that it seems to me we have to come to grips with. And I'm afraid that we won't. I'm afraid that we will kid ourselves for another period into believing that another miracle is going to come along. This miracle is going to be called shale gas. And we'll just say pretend that the constraint has been lifted until we discover that it hasn't been. Well, I don't know that food would be any different from energy. Food itself is not in short supply. In terms of the world population, it's a purchasing power question. But the cost of producing it is an energy cost. It's fundamentally, we no longer use the sun as the principal energy. A major energy source going into our food supply is fossil fuels. We spread a lot of oil on the fields. And so the two things are, should not be separated. They're the same issue. I gather the subtitle of this book is something to the effect, why everything you ever thought you knew about economics is wrong. Okay, well, that gives you an idea that this is not the humblest of author ever to speak at the Harvard bookstore, for example. So I think that's first of all. Secondly, this is a private equity guy. Well, yeah, he's a friend of your partner, or at least a partner. He's a private equity guy,
yeah.
Right? Creative entrepreneur, a creative destruction. Well, destruction, yeah. The creation, not so much. Again, another Cambridge figure, Schumpeter. Schumpeter's point, and this is, I will just assume that what we're seeing here is Schumpeter for the age of Mitt Romney. Schumpeter's point was that the capitalist system improves living standards by technological transformation. And this is something Schumpeter observed accurately in his time, and his view of competition was, I think, much better. It's a much more vivid, true-to-life portrait than the textbook portrait of competition. His use of the word is better. But Schumpeter was working on the economic history of the century before he wrote, during which all kinds of massive advances were occurring. Right. What we have in the last 30 years, we have the period from 1990 to 2000, we have the digitization, information technology revolution. It certainly has changed a great many things. I think it's arguable whether those things are as fundamental as, let's say, the advances in transportation and in chemistry and in medicine and in materials and so forth of the previous century. Basically, it's one innovation that goes out and is replicated in a lot of different contexts. And so reducing the cost of communication and computation technologies. There's that question of, but even if I concede that the information technology revolution was just as vital as Bill Clinton always said it was when he was president, then what came afterwards? What came afterwards was a revolution of innovations in finance, in the securitization of subprime mortgages, in quantitative risk management, in the creation of collateralized debt obligations and their squares and cubes, in this magnificent thing to which we all owe so much progress, the credit default swap. Right? I mean, forget it. This is not, it strikes me, a persuasive argument for allowing private equity guys to run the world or to give us their, to accept their interpretation of what is a desirable economic development. I just offer that as a completely off the head, off the top of my head, never thought about it before, reaction to your Well, I don't think there's any reason to believe that eroding fair labor standards, conditions of work, is going to improve employment performance. You have two effects. One is maybe, arguably, but very little evidence, that a few more jobs are offered to people who wouldn't otherwise get them. Undeniably, a great many people who already have jobs get paid less and their purchasing power is reduced. Right? That's a, by any calculation, a much bigger effect. And that is why I have recently been arguing for a very substantial increase in the minimum wage. That's $12 an hour, that's my target. And the reason, actually there's a very interesting coalition forming around this. I took my cue from the publisher of a magazine called The American Conservative, who wrote a very persuasive article on this point, a guy by the name of Ron Unz, a physicist, as it turns out. And it got picked up with a serious, not necessarily an endorsement, but a respectful mention by somebody in the Weekly Standard. And so I'm thinking, well, maybe it's possible for people thinking about this issue coherently, and maybe coming at it from different reasoning, to coalesce around something that would really make a substantial difference at the low end of the pay scale. Not necessarily here. I bet there are not that many jobs around here that are at the low end of that pay scale. But in parts of the country where I come from in particular, I understand the median construction wage in Texas is now around $10 an hour. That's what I'm told. Right? And what is that? That's a lot of people with one pickup truck, okay? Picking up workers who'd have no benefits at all, raising the standard there would have a very significant effect on the structure of the industry. And yes, small business people who are affected would have to adjust, But they would have to pay their workers more, but then they would find their customers coming through the door with better incomes and stronger demand for their goods and services. And so it's not at all obvious that they would be worse off. In fact, when you look at this in any kind of comparative context, you find that countries which have higher minimums and stronger standards, as I said before, don't have worse unemployment performance. In fact, the contrary, they have better. So I think this is a gamble I would take. And you know, I wish that it had been introduced by the president alongside the Buffett rule. Right? You know, one symbolic gesture, which, by the way, would have cost our friend Mitt Romney several million dollars personally on his taxes, which I'm sure I wrote was something that would give universal pleasure to the American population. The editor who was working that piece said, "What about Romney's supporters?" I said, "Even his supporters don't like him." So she left it in. I am going to take up the question of the crisis and what it means going forward in a book that I'm working on now. And let's bring it back to from Chicago to Cambridge. We talk about William James and the structures of belief and the need for belief as a motivation to action. There is something to be said about having a population which has confidence that it can achieve what it's out to do. Otherwise, it's going to try. By running the system in a highly unstable way, by allowing the thing to blow up and fall apart, and then patching it together and watching that not work, we are creating a very adverse psychological climate. And I think that is something which you can, in fact, put into a formal framework for thinking about these issues. I have some papers which begin to explore that type of a framework. This book, on the other hand, is really much more, it's a much more prosaic and modest exercise. It is an attempt to bring together a body of measurement and to find patterns and to say a few things that, at some level, when you have the evidence, are I think really very compelling, such as that there is a relationship between inequality as we measure it and the stability, the instability of the system. That is so, regulating the system to keep inequality under control is the equivalent of a stabilizing mechanism, moderating mechanism, such as the fact that we do live in a world where dominant forces are global and financial, and where controlling those forces and reducing the weight of incomes in the financial sector is a crucial step toward reducing inequality. It also reduces the inequality not only of wealth but also of power, because obviously the more concentrated one is, the more concentrated the other is. We do have evidence that in some parts of the world, and particularly this is in Latin America now, that some progress has actually been made, which tells us that it's possible. And that's also a good thing. And I'll just close out by saying that if you wanted to sum up my philosophy on this matter, the sentence I always love to quote is the shortest and I think the best sentence in the entire inquiry into the nature and causes of the wealth of nations by Adam Smith. And it's simply, "Wealth is power, as Mr. Hobbes says." Thanks very much.